thing that we all know and love. Food. From the morning when we see eggs and bacon to when we finally get to eat a spoonful of ice cream for dessert, we know that food is such a huge part of our everyday lives. But when it comes to food, it's not just about the different textures and colors. Rather, it is the unique smell of each ingredient that really gets us going. When your nose catches a whiff of one of the chemical clouds from foods like garlic and onions, you are experiencing one of our most ancient and powerful senses. This is what we call olfaction, known more commonly as our keen sense of smell. What's interesting is that the olfactory system works just like a highly organized factory. Although you don't think about it all the time, many parts in the olfactory system are working non-stop to deliver microscopic odor molecules from the outside world right to your brain. The relationship between the olfactory system and the brain is super complex and interconnected. Olfaction is part of the chemosensory system and allows us to convert distant airborne chemicals into information that we can process in our brains. Using specific pathways in the central nervous system, these electrical responses are directly transported to various regions of the brain. This is different from how we process sights and sounds, because those responses must first make a pit stop in the middle of the cerebral hemisphere before traveling anywhere else. So, how does it all work? What exactly is going on when we use our noses? Well, imagine yourself walking into your kitchen and seeing someone chopping peppers in front of you. As you breathe in the air, tiny chemical compounds, called odorants, swirl into your nostrils and fly straight into your nasal passages. These odor molecules then get stuck in a mucous membrane called the olfactory epithelium, where millions of receptor proteins hang out in the hair-like dendrites of olfactory sensory neurons. Almost 1,000 different olfactory receptor proteins are designed to detect specific odor molecules. Here, each odor molecule gets paired up with its matching receptor protein, like how only one key will unlock its matching door. Once the molecule binds with a receptor protein, electrical signals begin to travel up the railroad tracks of the olfactory neurons to get to the brain. After passing through a thin bony structure called the cribriform plate, the neural impulses meet at the olfactory bulb. Mitral cells, which are located in these rather tiny bulbs, pass the sensory information from the nerves to different parts in the body's most highly respected headquarters. But instead of sending this information to random places, it gets transported to the major limbic structures, such as the amygdala, hippocampus, and the hypothalamus. Well, what do these parts even do? Close your eyes and try to think back to that exact moment when you smelled grandma's perfume, or perhaps when you first opened your old history textbook. You should probably be able to strongly remember how you felt when I mentioned those particular smells. It's really all thanks to your brain's limbic system that we have this deep, powerful connection between smells, memories, and emotions. Now, even though we can sense odors the same way, we don't interpret them the same way. This is because the associations we make with different smells are pretty much learned throughout our lives. For example, try to imagine the smell of an onion and the smell of licorice. If you were to ask adults to differentiate these two smells to be pleasant or unpleasant, they would probably be able to do it in a second. But researchers found that if you were to present the same two smells to newborn babies, the babies would just avoid all of the smells because the smells don't hold any personal meaning to them. By the time they reach their 8th birthday, most children's reactions to odors will be very similar to those of adults within that culture. We often form such strong associations between feelings and odors that these learned associations can then influence our behavior in ways that are below our level of consciousness. Aromatherapy is one practice that is based upon the belief that various natural odors, such as mint and lavender, have the power to relax our mood and physical state. Many studies have shown that scents can have a surprising effect on our behavior when used in the right settings. For example, one study conducted in a casino in Las Vegas found that a slot machine area filled with a pleasant odor resulted in customers gambling 45% more than customers in a room without any manipulated odors. Smells can also affect the way we think of new people. Another study had participants sniff bottles that contained a lemony odor, a neutral odor, and a stinky odor. The participants were then asked to rate how likable a photograph of a face looked. What do you think happened? Well, even though the exact same face was used for every participant, people rated the faces to be less likable after sniffing the bad smell and more likable after the pleasant smell. The strong associations we form through smells not only influence our social judgments, but can also be used to influence our moral behavior, specifically how generous we are. A couple of scientists recently discovered that when participants were in a room sprayed with citrus aromas from Windex, they were more willing to donate money to charity and more willing to share their money with an anonymous stranger. Whether it is an odor that makes you smile or an odor that makes you feel sick, smells certainly have the power to influence our social and moral behavior. Olfaction is a sense that is often overlooked, and there are still so many things for us to discover about our amazing ability to smell. But for now, maybe we should just take a break, sit back, relax, and enjoy some freshly baked cupcakes. Maybe the cupcakes' aromas will trigger some kind of change in our behavior. For all we know, creating happier people may just be a few bites away.